mighty King of heaven. To his feet your tribute bring. Ransom healed, restored, forgiven. Evermore his praises sing. King, praise him, praise him. He's over everything. Who's gonna stop the king?
All right, good morning, everybody. All right, we seem a little heavy on the left side here, but that's okay. Farther away from the spray zone, right? So, all right, well, good morning. Let's open up in prayer, and then we will worship together here this morning. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for a beautiful day outside. Lord, we just thank you for a wonderful time to come together corporately to worship your name, to bring you glory and honor and praise, Lord, and to just dive into the riches of your word this morning. So we just invite your spirit and your presence into this place, Lord. I just pray that we would honor you as we worship, Father, that we would glorify you as we study your word and just bring joy to you as we fellowship together. So I just pray during this time, Lord, that you would just be in this place. Any burdens that we have, that we would just lay them before your throne as we worship you. In your mighty and precious name, amen. All right, will you stand with me? Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaken, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause he's never that makes me Background singer over there. She just doesn't know it yet. What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold. Dismiss our children off to Kid City. They beat me to it. And we will lift them up in prayer as they head down. And we will miss their singing up here very much. Heavenly Father, as always, Lord, we just thank you for these children, the joy they bring and the energy they exude, Lord. We just pray for just an ounce of that, Father, but I just pray as they are downstairs today that you just be with the teachers, you just give them the wisdom and the words to present to these children, and Lord, that they would just get to know you more and more, that they would see you as the one true God, as their Lord and Savior, that they would recognize their need for you, Father. And Lord, I just continue to pray for all the parents, grandparents, and aunts, uncles, friends, cousins, however we are associated or related, Lord, that we would also be built up in order to teach them and to be examples for them as well, Lord, because your word does say that they will not depart from their word, from your word, if they are taught it, Lord, and so I just pray that we are faithful in that manner, and as we continue up here, Lord, I just pray that we would continue to honor you in our worship and our praise. In your name we pray, amen. This is a song we haven't done in a little while, but as you'll see with the message this morning, it's just a wonderful reminder that in the midst of all things that we face, all trials and tribulations and griefs and sorrows that we face, that regardless of how those prayers are answered, or maybe we deem them not answered, that as believers we continue to give him our worship and our praise in the midst of it and trust him in his faithfulness. So, yeah, this is a song that's based on that, and the heart behind it is that we will continue to worship him, so let's do that.
Oh, yes, I will lift you high.
have some announcements for you.
Good morning. Here at City on a Hill, we do not pass an offering plate, but we do have a tithe box at the back of the sanctuary if you feel led to give. Restrooms and coffee are located over here. You can follow along with the weekly sermons on the YouVersion Bible app. You can access that by going to More, selecting Events, and then City on a Hill, Community Church, Indian River. If you'd like to receive text through Flocknote for church events and updates, and you haven't already given us your information, you can fill out the connection card, which are in the back of the seats, and then drop that in the tithe box. Two spring studies have already started, and it's not too late to sign up or on the table for the motivational giftings class with Pam. And youth group is starting up. We're going to do this. Start doing it on Wednesdays. It's going to be from 6 to 7:30, and it is 3rd through 6th grade. And you can contact, you can talk to me or Matt about that. And for the older kids, you can see Brad Shepperly. So for more information about what's going on at City on a Hill, you can check out our website, Facebook page, or the bulletin board, or by the bathroom. And we have Becky Fettig of Ronan's Place here. She's going to share about their ministry and what they offer our community.
Thank you. It's nice to be here. The last time I was here, I think we did a play with our homeschool group. So it's been a while ago. I just want to tell you how the Lord has blessed us and what the Lord's been doing at Ronan's Place. For those of you who do not know about Ronan's Place, our son Ronan was in an accident on May 7th back in 2018. A lady ran a red light and he T-boned her. He ended up with a traumatic brain injury. And then when he went back to doctors, he was turned away because he didn't have insurance, even though he had car insurance, which paid for his medical once everything was all said and done. But so in that process of him fighting with, he was a big football player. And so he started stuttering through all this time. He started hallucinating. And we finally were able to get him into the doctors that turned him away by getting a caseworker. But within a week and a half of being on the medication made things so much worse that he started shooting his hallucinations and then turned the gun on himself. So through all that, the Lord held us up. We had people praying for us, and we could feel the prayers. It was just amazing. But then it was in May of 2022, the Lord laid upon my heart to start Ronan's Place. And I'm like, Lord, you're funny. I'm like, I'm in the middle of planning our daughter's wedding. I don't have time for this. He's like, yes, you do. So between May and July, we had our LARA, our tax exemption, and 80 letters out to area churches and organizations. At our daughter's wedding rehearsal dinner, I got a call from a lady from the Transfiguration Episcopal Church offering us their building for Ronan's Place. So then I saw why the Lord said I had to be, do it before her wedding. So it's just neat when you can see, once you've got to that point, how the Lord was working before. So I'm glad I was obedient and did what I was told, because I don't always do that. But our statement, our mission statement at Ronan's Place is to provide help to those who suffer from depression, anxiety, suicide, domestic abuse, PTSD, and other mental health conditions, and to give hope to those who have none, while helping to empower them and to listen without judgment while showing them the love of Christ. So since this last Wednesday, the 17th, we were actually 1 year at our building on M68. If you haven't been there, stop by. I'm there Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays. It's a beautiful building, and everything in it has been donated. We've just been very blessed. We have two grief support groups. We have the third Monday at 10:30 in the morning and the third Thursday at 7 p.m. So far, we have helped 51 people. We try to reach out to the community to do different things that where we see a need. So we've been doing family fun days, family fun nights. We do movies, popcorn, and everything is free. And so in December, we collected coats. We collected over 200 coats for families, and then people could come in, get coats, and then stay for a popcorn and a movie. We had about 60 people come, about 50 people stayed for the movie. In February, we did a game night, and we collected food for the pantry here in town. And then in March, we did a movie night and collected more food for the pantry. We collected 2 8-foot tables of food for the pantry, and Chris was just so tickled because she said during the early months of the year, they don't get a lot of donations. The next thing that we're planning, we do a 5K in September. On the 21st, we'll have our 5K again. It's right here in town on the path, and you can either walk or run, and that is one of our big fundraisers. We also are going to do this year, the first time in October, we're going to do an Eat for Heat to help our community with people who need help in the wintertime with their heating costs. And hopefully that will be at the VFW Hall. We're still waiting on confirmation there, but save October 18th as a save the date type of thing, because that's when we're planning on having it. And then we'll do our coat fund drive again and for December 7th. It's been amazing to me different ways that I've been called upon by the Lord to help people. I've actually got a call from a 911 operator, and she asked if I would be patched in with a lady and talk with her until the police could get there. The police officer had just gotten my card the day before. So I talked with this lady for about 45 minutes. I'm like, okay, Lord, you're gonna have to help me because I have no idea what to do here. And so we made it through the 45 minutes. The police officer got on the phone when he got there and said, okay, I'm here. And I'm like, okay, good, because I wasn't really sure what all I should do. So I've been taking classes. I've been doing like the assist, which is with suicide prevention, talk, anything I can get my hands on, I've been taking classes just so I have more knowledge to help people when they call. We also have been blessed with estate sales. Since we're a nonprofit, we get the remnants from estate sales. That started last year with my husband's cousin loves estate sales, and so she was talking with a lady at an estate sale, and she's like, yes, you know, we give them to nonprofits. So we ended up with that company till the end of the summer, and through the month of July, we end up raising $10,000 from just estate sales, which it helps because with our ministry, with the counseling, if people don't have insurance or money, then Ronan's Place pays for it because we want to get them before they get to that suicidal point. We do have over on the table over there, we have pens, we have brochures, we have, are they not promise cards? What are they, honey? What's the name? Pledge cards. And we have people that do give monthly. We have churches that give monthly. We have people that get once a year, just a one-time gift. We have different things. We are always in need of volunteers, especially when we're doing the estate sales. Because on Sunday afternoon is when the estate sale is done, we have to go load it up and then bring it to Ronan's Place and unload it. So we're always looking for muscles. So if you'd like to do that, you can let me know or go on our website and fill out a volunteer form there. But it's just been a blessing. We've now switched to a different estate sales because I'm like, Lord, if you want us to continue with this, because it's a good income to be able to pay for the counseling, because we have a lot of people that can't afford it, and we want them to get the help. And so I said, you're either going to have to send us a trailer or someone who's willing to haul it for us, because we didn't have a trailer. And so I was sitting at my desk and on a Friday, and this estate sale popped up, and it was just right around the corner on Parkey Road. And I just felt the Lord prompting me to go there. So I went and was talking with the state sale person, Allison, and she's like, well, you can have this one. I'm like, well, we don't have any way to haul it. She's like, we'll haul it for you. And so then when her husband was helping us unload it on Sunday, he's like, you want the next one? I said, we don't have a way to haul it. He goes, I'll haul all of them for you. So that was the answer to the prayer on that one, that we needed someone to haul them for us. But it's just so neat to see how the Lord just keeps blessing. We have the estate sale open. We don't have an in-house counselor right now. We have two telehealth counselors, which is nice because we can do the whole state of Michigan. We're not just, don't have to do local. We can help people throughout the whole state of Michigan, which is a real blessing, because there's a lot of places that it's a month waiting list to get in. And there's sometimes they don't have a month to wait to get into a counselor. They need to see someone now. And so, but if you know of someone, we would like to have an in-house counselor for ones that are local. It's harder for our older people because they aren't necessarily real technology focused, and they would rather talk to a person and not a phone or a computer. So that is, and just please pray. We covet your prayers. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Becky, for coming and sharing your heart and your obedience. It's just amazing to see what God does with that obedience. And so, I just ask you guys would prayerfully consider how we can come alongside them and support them, because they're doing a wonderful work here in the community and obviously the surrounding area of Michigan in general. So it's amazing stuff. Well, with that said, I want to wish you guys a good morning. It's great to see you guys here this Sunday. If you haven't been here in recent times, we're still continuing our way through the book of Luke. We are now in the middle of chapter 7. But last week we concluded Jesus' Sermon on the Plain. And if you're not familiar with that, it's these teachings, he's exhorting his disciples not to just be hearers of the word, that's what we looked at last week, but also doers of the word. And then the call then is for each of us who proclaim Christ to be imitators of him. And the result, he says, is the one that who is a hearer and also a doer of God's word is like the one who builds their life on a firm foundation, one who remains strong, who remains upright and sturdy in the midst of the storms of this life. And after giving this message, it's very interesting, as we're going to see, he meets people in the midst of these trials, in the midst of these storms of life. The first thing, as we looked at last week, the opening portion of chapter 7, Jesus makes his way into the town of Capernaum, where he's met by some Jewish elders of the local synagogue, and with them is a request that they are carrying. And they ask Jesus to come to the house of a Roman centurion, and the request is that he would heal this man's servant who is near death. But what we learn through this passage is what remarkable faith looks like through the humble centurion. And he approaches Jesus, he approaches him in his humility, and in the midst of this, he's understanding of who he is, and just as important or equally important, understanding who Jesus is. And so he makes this request, and he makes it with simple certainty in the ability and the power of Jesus. He says, just say the word and let my servant be healed. And so it's with this man's faith that Jesus finds himself marveling. And only two times in scripture do we see it recorded for us that Jesus is marveling. The first time we saw in Luke chapter 4, where he's marveling at the unbelief of the people from his local town. And this time we see him marveling at the faith of this Gentile Roman centurion. As he says that, I tell you, not even in Israel have I found such faith. And of course, in response to this man's faith, in response to his humble approach and request, Jesus heals the servant. And in the midst of his need, the centurion we see rested fully in Jesus. He understood who Jesus was again and is, and because of that, his faith was certain and it was confident. And so with that, we really find ourselves now really in the midst, in the middle of Jesus' active ministry. His ministry really started back in chapter 4, where he read from the scroll of Isaiah in the synagogue in Nazareth. But we see that the pace seems to pick up a bit here in Luke's gospel. And Jesus begins making his way from town to town. And with him, his disciples following along, and miracles are being done in the midst of the people. And so today's message, we're going to focus on Luke chapter 7, verses 11 through 17. Initially, my plan was to do a couple of passages here, but I really did not want us to just gloss over this. I really want us to focus on this because it really shows us the character and nature of Christ. And so this message is going to focus on Jesus as he ministers to a widow.
and her son, and more specifically her son who has recently passed away. And so this is the first time that we will see Jesus raise someone from the dead. And as we study this passage, my hope and my aim is to look through the lens of grief and how Christ responds to it and how he responds to us in the midst of our grief and what it means for us today. I also want us to recognize how the people in the crowd here responded to Jesus's miracle and how we can apply that to our lives as well. So with that said, if you have your Bible with you this morning, if you'd open with me to Luke chapter 7, beginning in verse 11, I want to pray before we read and study this together. Dear Heavenly Father, we again come to you today. Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your compassion as we are about to read. And Lord, if there's anyone here carrying a heavy burden, maybe they come through these doors with grief and sorrow upon their shoulders, I just pray that this would be an encouragement to them. Father, that it would be a reminder of your deep love for each of us, Lord, and that it would just be a reminder to draw near to you more and more each day. And Lord, we just thank you that you have given us your word, that we can know you, even if it's just a glimpse, Father, that you reveal your nature and your character to us and your heart towards us. And I just pray that, again, this would draw us to you, that we'd find encouragement in your word today. And I ask this in your mighty, precious, and holy name. Amen. Okay, Luke chapter 7, beginning in verse 11. Soon afterward, he, being Jesus, went to a town called Nain, and his disciples and a great crowd went with him. As he drew near to the gate of the town, behold, a man who had died was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow. And a considerable crowd from the town was with her. And when the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her and said to her, "Do not weep." Then he came up and touched the bier, and the bearer stood still, and he said, "Young man, I say to you, arise." And the dead man sat up and began to speak, and Jesus gave him to his mother. Fear seized them all, and they glorified God, saying, "A great prophet has arisen among us, and God has visited his people." And this report about him spread through the whole of Judea and all the surrounding country. So soon after, we read last week, the healing of the centurion's servant, Jesus, along with his throng of disciples, they make their way now to a town called Nain. This is a town that's still around to this very day. It goes by the name of Nin or Nine, so they just change the vowels for some reason in between, but it's still there. It's roughly 24 to 25 miles on foot from Capernaum, which is where he came from with the Roman centurion's servant. And of course, Capernaum sits on the northern shores of the Sea of Galilee, and this sits northeast of this town called Nain. Now, Nain is a quaint little town. It's nestled in the northwestern slope of Mount Moriah, and it's a very small town, and it's a relatively poor area during Jesus' day. The population, it's unknown at this time, but if records serve to be accurate, it's fluctuated from as low as 500 to today has about 1,500 people. So we understand that to be pretty small. And this is the only time that we see this town mentioned in Scripture. But just because its appearance in Scripture is brief does not mean it holds no significance. For as I stated earlier, this is the first time that Jesus raises someone from the dead. The name Nain is important for us to know too. It means lovely, or it means green pastures. And I find it very fitting because pastures that are green really represent life. And that's exactly what Jesus brings, both physically in the story here, but also, more importantly, spiritually. But as he enters into this little town, he's met with the harrowing death, a reality of death, right? He's walking into this town, and on the way out of this town, he's met with this young man who has just recently died. It's a death of a son at that. And so we don't know how old the man was. He's no longer a child because they call him a man. But regardless, we have to understand that to his mother, it would still be the death of her child. Right? Anyone who has adult children understands that you probably see them in the light of your children, right? They're still your kid. They're still your child. And so she has lost her child. This was her son. And I feel it's really necessary, guys, as hard as it is to really focus on this, I think it's important that we understand that it's necessary that we come to grips with the emotional context of the story. So many times I've been guilty of just kind of reading a passage. You get these facts from it, but they don't really hit us, right? We just kind of read through, okay, so this was a son, he died, now he's risen from the dead. That's really cool. That's an amazing story. But we have to understand the emotional context of what's going on here. This was a son, and this mother is grieving heavily. And I hope that we can gain a deeper understanding and appreciation of Jesus' heart and ministry as we go through this study together. So Jesus, upon entering this town, encounters this funeral procession of sorts. This man recently passed away, is being carried out on a funeral bier. It's a frame that they would place the coffin on and be carried out, kind of like pallbearers today. And immediately followed behind by what Jesus would recognize to be this man's mother. And with her is a considerable crowd, it says, and likely some of those would be mourners, you know, professional mourners they would have in the day. But he sees, and we see, recognize here that she must be weeping, because he tells her to not weep. And upon seeing his mother, and understandably she would be weeping bitterly here and likely beside herself, the sight fills Jesus with compassion, right? Jesus lays his eyes upon this woman, and he recognizes her grief. And so there's two words in verse 13 that really stuck out to me. The first one, of course, is compassion. And we're going to get to that word shortly, what it means and what it means for us today. But the first word is simply saw, right? In verse 13, he says, "And when the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her, and he said to her, 'Do not weep.'" So the word saw. And so in regards to this mother's grief, it says that Jesus saw her, right? He perceived her condition, and he recognized that there was grief going on inside her. And there isn't some deeper spiritual meaning behind this word. The word saw in the Greek really just means to behold or to stare at. So he physically saw this woman, and in her eyes and in her, the way she was carrying herself, he recognized a heavy grief, a heavy sorrow upon her. And so I really want us to consider the beauty of this moment. It's another example in Scripture that the God we worship and the God we serve is not apathetic towards us. He's not apathetic towards his people. On the contrary, time and again, Scripture reveals that he loves us deeply. And in the midst of our grief, guys, if you are here and you carry a burden today, know that he sees you. He sees you. He beholds you. And so when you feel like you're utterly alone in the midst of your sorrow and in the midst of your bitterness, you feel like no one understands, you know, no one seems to see me in my bitterness and in my sorrow and in my pain, know that God sees you. He sees you. In Hebrews 4:15, it says that we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. So we see this and we understand that Jesus understands temptation, right? He understands the reality of our weaknesses and frailties and our limitations in our human condition. That's what the author of Hebrews was pointing out here. But what is more, if we take these words and also look at the words of the prophetic, the prophetic words of Isaiah, in Isaiah 53, verse 3, he also understands our sorrow and our grief. It says, "He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised and we esteemed him not." Now, if you've never read Isaiah 53, I recommend and encourage you maybe this week to take time and read through it. It's called The Suffering Servant, but it gives us a beautiful glimpse into the reality that Jesus understands grief. He understands our pain. He understands sorrow and the heaviness that comes with living in this world. And because of Jesus' personal understanding of sorrow and grief, he is empathetic towards those who grieve. So again, if you find yourselves in the throes of sorrow, if you find yourselves in heavy grief, my prayer, guys, is that you can find some solace in the reality that Jesus not only sees you, but he understands your plight. He understands the heaviness that you carry. And in our passage this morning, I love that he doesn't stop at seeing and understanding. He doesn't behold this woman and understand how she's feeling and say, you know, that's tough, but I think she'll see it through. The heavy grief of this woman stirs Jesus' heart to compassion, and that compassion stirs him into action. So look at verses 13 and 14 now. It says, "When the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her and said to her, 'Do not weep.' Then he came up and touched the bearer, and the bearer stood still, and he said, 'Young man, I say to you, arise.'" The wording Luke chooses here, I think he chose these words very carefully, but he chose the strongest possible selection that he could have made in the Greek language. The root word for compassion, it's very interesting if you understand the context of this ancient of ancient Israel here, it refers to the bowels. So to us, we're like, that's kind of weird. But in the ancient Jewish culture, the bowels were thought to be the seat of love and pity. Right? So think of for a moment, you see someone that you love, and right, you get butterflies in your stomach, right? And like, oh, you know, they feel that way. Or you see something heartbreaking, right? And it just stirs in you, like almost sick to your stomach to feel or experience that. That's kind of what they're talking about. So they saw the bowels as the seat of love and pity. It's very similar today to how we recognize our heart in our culture, right? You know, my heart breaks for that person, or, you know, my heart's filled with joy upon seeing that person. So for them, it was the bowels. For us, it's the heart. But it also describes an emotion so strong that it had a physical effect on Jesus. So quite literally, Jesus felt compassion for this woman. It elicited not just an emotional response, but a physical one. There's a man by the name of E.V. Rue. He explains that Jesus gave way to such distress of spirit as made his body tremble. That's how the word is, you know, how we can translate it into our language. It literally brought a physical response to him. And I think it's very important to note, this is not just a one-off response from Jesus, right? This isn't just, okay, well, maybe he just felt, for some reason, this woman, he felt a deep compassion for. This is something we see throughout his ministry, throughout the Gospels, while he is here on earth. And so I just want to run through five other examples. We're not going to stop and explain each one, but I just want us to pinpoint the areas where it tells us he has compassion or he has pity upon the people, and recognize that this is a common element and theme and character of Jesus. So Matthew 9, 35 through 38, it says, Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom, healing every disease and every affliction. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to the disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. So as he's going from town to town, village to village, he's healing these people who are coming to him. But as he's surrounded by these crowds, he begins to see these people as helpless and harassed, right? They're wandering, but they don't really have a shepherd to lead them. And when he sees that, it says he had compassion for them. It broke him. It broke his heart to see this. And so he began to heal them and to minister to them. Matthew 14, 13 through 14 says that when Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a desolate place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion on them and healed their sick. Again, he's seeing people, and it brings him to compassion, right? He's seeing these people that are sick, who are hurting, who are broken. Matthew 15, verses 32 and then 35 through 37 says, then Jesus called his disciples and said, I have compassion on the crowd, because they have been with me now 3 days and have nothing to eat, and I am unwilling to send them away hungry, lest they faint on the way. In verse 35, and directing the crowd to sit down on the ground, he took 7 loaves of the fish, and having given thanks, he broke them and gave them to the disciples. The disciples gave them to the crowds, and they all ate and were satisfied, and they took up 7 baskets full of the broken pieces left over. So again, he sees the people in their plight and their condition, and he ministers to them. Two more here, Matthew 20, verses 29 through 34. As they went out of Jericho, a great crowd followed him. And behold, there were 2 blind men sitting by the roadside. And when they heard that Jesus was passing by, they cried out, Lord, have mercy on us, son of David. The crowd rebuked them, telling them to be silent. But they cried out all the more, Lord, have mercy on us, son of David. And stopping, Jesus called them and said, what do you want me to do for you? They said to him, Lord, let our eyes be opened. And Jesus, in pity, touched their eyes and immediately recovered the sight and followed them. Pity and compassion are the same words here. Just translated differently into our language. And then Mark 1, last one, 40 through 42. And a leper came to him, imploring him, and kneeling, said to him, if you will, you can make me clean. Again, moved with pity, he stretched out his hand, touched him, and said to him, I will be clean. And immediately the leprosy left him, and he was made clean. So you likely recognized it here, but in case you didn't, notice that with every one of these examples, his compassion moves him into action. He takes action over these people. You know, it's not this, oh man, I really feel bad for them, but there's nothing I can really do. Good luck to you on your way. You know, I hope they can figure it out. But their condition, we have to see, draws Jesus in, and he responds out of that pity, out of that compassion, to minister to them in the midst of their need. Jesus is the ultimate display, guys, of selflessness and sacrifice, for which allows him to exhibit the full exercise of his pity and his compassion. And so from the examples that we see in these Gospels, I believe it's very clear that Jesus' heart of compassion is big enough to minister to our grieving hearts, no matter how big that grief is. It's big enough to meet us in the midst of our hardship. His heart is big enough to meet us in the midst of our trials. You know, out of all places, right, the book of Lamentations, right, a book of actual lamenting, right, crying out to God. In chapter 3, there's a lot of hope here that I hope, you know, my prayer is that we can hold on to these words and, you know, and apply them to our hearts and be filled with that joy and that hope. It says, the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases, right? It never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. You know, we don't like to use absolutes all the time, but with Jesus, with God, we can use absolutes, right? His love never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They're new every single morning. I hope that you can find some encouragement if you're in the midst of grief today. Now, in his movement of compassion, Jesus also had words for this weeping widow, right? He says, do not weep. Now, we have to understand, this isn't a calloused response, right? You know, sometimes we look at the time when Jesus, you know, at the wedding feast, his mom is telling him, you know, you need to do something. It's time for you to enter in the ministry. And he's like, woman? And we look at that, we're like, geez, that's kind of disrespectful, you know? If I call my mom woman, there'd be a quick hand to the face there before I could even get the word out. And rightly so, but when we understand the culture of the day, it's actually a very respectful, a very humble response that Jesus is giving. But the way it translated into our language, we're like, wow, that's tough. So we see this, you know, do not weep. You're like, I think the situation calls for it, Jesus. You know, this is a very difficult situation that we're facing. You know, but he's not saying, suck it up. You know, what are you crying for? You know, he's like Tom Hanks in, what's that movie, A League of Their Own, right? There's no crying at a funeral. You know, he's not saying that. It's, you know, quit that blubbering. No, he's hinting at something that he's about to do, right? He's hinting that there's going to be something miraculous about to happen for her and her son. And so in speaking directly to her, when he says, do not weep, right, he's essentially saying to her, I see you, I see your pain, and I'm here for you, right? I see you, I understand what you're feeling, and I'm here to serve you. So look at verses 14 and 15. It says, then he came up and touched the bear, and the bear stood still. And he said, young man, I say to you, arise. And the dead man sat up, began to speak, and Jesus gave him to his mother. The first thing I want to touch on here, pun intended, is that Jesus is touching the bear, right? He puts his hand upon it. And to do this, it was, according to the law of the day, it would make one ceremonially unclean. And the book of Numbers says this. In Numbers 19:11, whoever touches the dead body of any person shall be unclean 7 days. That included what was carrying the dead body. So according to the law, this was a defiling act, but Jesus understood that the law required mercy over sacrifice. In Hosea 6, verse 6, this is the words of God. He says, I desire steadfast love and not sacrifice, the knowledge of God rather than burnt offerings. In other words, I want your heart, right? I want you to understand that the heart is more important than just outward, you know, obedience. If there's outward obedience, but there's no true love or desire for God behind it, it doesn't mean anything. And Jesus is a living testimony of the passage in Hosea. And we see time and again throughout his ministry, right? He's technically breaking the law, right? He's healing people on the Sabbath. You're not supposed to work. It's like unbelievable, right? They're throwing a big fit. You can't heal that guy. It's the Sabbath, you know? And he's like, your heart is so backwards, you know? And he's just teaching people that the law is something far different than how they've been following it. And time and again throughout Luke's gospel, it's also, he's been purposefully revealing to us the power and authority that Jesus has over his creation, right? And he only needs to speak a word and it will come to pass. Just last week, the centurion, right? He said, just say a word and my servant will be healed. He never entered the house of the centurion, but the centurion's servant was healed. To the paralytic, right? Jesus not only forgave his sins, but by a word, he healed the man of his paralysis. To the leper, similarly to our passage this morning, it says that he reached out and touched the man. Again, leprous would be considered unclean, but he touched him and by his word healed this man. And I think that Luke is making it painstakingly clear that Jesus had divine power and authority, but he also had a generous heart of love and compassion. He doesn't just heal physical ailments, but he also ministered to the heart of the people, right? He shows us what selfless and sacrificial love looks like, and it's a beautiful thing. And I know that we can kind of turn this and say, okay, if we're going to be, representations of Christ, if we're going to be like him, if we want to emulate him, then we too need to show compassion to people. And yes, that is very true, and we can go in that direction. But I really felt that God was leading me in this passage this morning to really focus on his character and his nature and be encouraged this morning by it, to be reminded of who he is. And so Jesus, his heart is overcome with compassion. It tells us he reaches out, he speaks to the dead man saying, "Young man, I say to you, arise." And immediately the dead man sits up, he begins to speak. And again, we see that his power brings forth this immediate response and an immediate healing from this young man, just as it has in previous times. We see this one from death to life. And so what is the response of the people, right? And what can we learn from the crowd here this morning? Let's take a look in verses 16 and 17. Fear seized them all, and they glorified God, saying, "A great prophet has arisen among us, and God has visited his people." And this report about him spread through the whole of Judea and all the surrounding country. Now, before I really study the response of the crowd and its importance, I do find it very interesting that there is a very, very similar parallel passage in the Old Testament. And perhaps this is the passage that the people are recalling as they're calling him a great prophet. And I don't think it comes as a coincidence either, and I don't think anything in Scripture is a coincidence. But the prophet Elijah in 1 Kings 17 would, he would raise an only son of a widow from the dead as well. So let's look at some of the parallels here. 1 Kings 17, 17 through 24. It says, "After this, the son of the woman, the mistress of the house, became ill, and his illness was so severe that there was no breath left in him. And she said to Elijah, 'What have you against me, O man of God? You have come to bring me my sin to remembrance and to cause the death of my son.' And he said to her, 'Give me your son.' And he took him from her arms and carried him up into the upper chamber where he lodged and laid him on his own bed. And he cried out to the Lord, 'O Lord, my God, you have brought calamity even upon the widow with whom I sojourned by killing her son.' And then he stretched himself upon the child three times and cried out to the Lord, 'O Lord, my God, let this child's life come into him again.' And the Lord listened to the voice of Elijah, and the life of the child came into him again, and he revived. And Elijah took the child and brought him down from the upper chamber into the house, again delivered him to his mother. And Elijah said, 'See, your son lives.' And the woman said to Elijah, 'Now I know you are a man of God, that the word of the Lord in your mouth is truth.'" Some striking similarity of a widow, her son has passed away, it's brought back to life. We see that Jesus, in our passage this morning, gave the son to his mother. It says that Elijah delivered him to his mother. It's the same phrase in the Greek. But it's not just the language that holds similarity, it's also the results, right? The response of the onlookers in each passage. In 1 Kings, the only onlooker we see is the mother, but she has a similar response to the crowds in name. Right? For the widow in 1 Kings, the miracle caused her to be convinced that Elijah, she says, was a man of God. So this was a phrase that meant she understood him to be a prophet, and that he spoke the truth of God's word. In our passage in Luke this morning, the crowd's response is fear and praising God, even calling Jesus a great prophet. So it sounds pretty familiar, doesn't it? There's, even the response is familiar. But first and foremost, let's focus on the first thing that Luke mentions in their response. The first response is what? It's the word fear. Fear came over them. The Greek word is phobos. It's where we get our suffix phobia, right? It means to strike terror or dread, but it can also mean reverence. And so there is then a literal fear of seeing a dead man sit up and begin to speak. I think all of us would be like, "What just happened? What's going on?" But there's also a reverence for Jesus here. And fear is the proper response that we should have before a holy God. But sadly, I would contend that in our culture today, even in the church, there's not a proper fear of God. There isn't enough talk or understanding of his holiness and what that means for us. We want to see him as just a friend, right? A buddy that we can confide in. And while his desire is for us to come to him, and he calls his disciples friends, right? And his call, he desires us to lay our burdens at his feet. We must never forget that we also bow before those feet. You know, when I was in high school, there was a popular shirt that a lot of kids liked to wear. It had a picture of Jesus' face, and around it said, "Jesus is my homeboy." Right? And we're like, oh, you know, that's so cool. That's so hip, you know. And looking back, I'm thankful none of us were struck down in our ignorance. It must be in our ignorance that God spared his wrath and extended us some of his grace. But if I'm honest, Jesus isn't my homeboy. We're not on equal ground. He is my savior, right? He's my king. It tells us he is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I'm just a sinner saved by his immense grace, right? We're not on the same level here at all. Reverence and awe of God need to return to the modern day church. It's something that we are lacking in our culture today. Reverence and awe, understanding what this looks like. I think the book of Hebrews gives us a wonderful picture of it. So if we're like, what does that even mean? What does it mean to fear God? How does that look? How do I apply that to my life? Hebrews 12, 28 through 29 says, "Therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. And thus, let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and awe." And here's the part that should bring us some reverence and awe. "For our God is a consuming fire." That sounds terrifying to me. He is a consuming fire. So the question for us this morning, do we revere God? Right? Do we kneel before him in awe? I don't want us to take God lightly. And I'm not sure this is exactly how the crowd responded, but perhaps it is, and we can contend, because the following reaction really is right in line with Hebrews 12. It tells us they glorified God. And Hebrews 12 says, "Let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and awe." And they proclaim, you know, "A great prophet has arisen among us." So they're getting close to who Jesus is, right? They're kind of there, but they're not all the way there yet. They're seeing something of God. They're saying that God has come before his people, right? That he's visited his people, but the prophet thing is not all the way there, right? He is the Son of God. He is the Savior of the world. He is the Messiah that was prophesied to them. And then they shout, "God has visited his people." This is really reminiscent, actually, of Zechariah in Luke chapter 1. If you don't know who Zechariah is, he was the father of John the Baptist. And when he was in the temple, he gets this prophetic word from an angel that says that he's going to have a son who's going to be the forebearer, the forerunner of the Messiah. And he says that blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited, but he also says, and redeemed his people. And lastly, it tells us here that the words began to spread in the area about Jesus. So there's really three responses here. First, there's fear, there's praising and worshiping, and then spreading the word about him. And this is really exactly what we're called to do as believers. We're to have proper fear and reverence of God. We are to worship and to glorify him, and we are to proclaim his name to the world around us. This is the proper response when we experience Jesus, when he brings us from death to eternal life. As John 5:24 says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my words," says Jesus, "and believes him who sent me has eternal life. He does not come into judgment, but has passed from death to life." And as remarkable as the miracle that we just read this morning, of bringing a dead man physically back to life, the salvific work of the cross, the forgiveness of sin, the gift of eternal life is far more miraculous, as far as I'm concerned. And so as we close this morning, a couple things I want to go over. I want to do a quick recap first. And so the first thing, guys, we must remember that Jesus understands our sorrow, okay? He sees us in the midst of our grief, and his heart is moved to compassion for the brokenhearted. Right? In Psalm 34:18, I feel like I've done this verse a lot lately, and there's probably a need for it, but it says, "The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit." In Psalm 147, verse 3, very similarly, it says, "He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds." So we know where we need to turn when we're brokenhearted, right? When we are facing sorrow and grief. Sometimes it's so heavy we don't understand it. We turn to him. If you're carrying a heavy burden or a broken heart, and perhaps, again, there's not a soul that seems to understand your pain, I promise you there is one that does. So even if you cannot find a person here that can understand fully what you're going through, there is a Savior, there is a God who does. And I encourage you to throw yourself into the tender arms of Jesus, and you will find healing. So turn your grieving heart to Christ. It's the first exhortation. So we see, again now, in our study, the first thing we recognize is Christ's awesome compassion. But the second now is Christ's awesome power. So not only is our God compassionate, but he is moved in compassion to minister to us in our deepest hurts and our deepest needs. And with just a word, we see time and again that he brings here the dead to life. And it's by his word that you will find healing. But maybe you look at this passage, you say, that's all well and good. And it's amazing that he, you know, has healed lepers and blind men and people that are lame and can't walk, but he didn't heal who I prayed for. You know, what about the unanswered prayer? What about the healing that didn't come? You ask. That's a fair question to ask. And I wish, standing up here, I had the answers to those great mysteries. I really do. I wish I could give you an answer and say, this is why. And you say, oh, okay, I understand now. Thank you. I've wrestled with those questions myself. And it would be insincere of me to not stand up here and not tell you that I've shaken my fist a time or two at God and gotten mad and say, why? It doesn't make sense to me. Why this person, but not this person? It doesn't make sense. But what I've come to learn in those times, and if you haven't been here before, I've shared in the past, I had a friend that passed away in eighth grade. A freak accident. He fell off the back of a truck, and the truck stalled and rolled back and killed him. And that was the first time I'd really faced anything in my faith, where I was like, wait a minute, you know, they say God's good. They say he's faithful, but why? Why did this happen? Why is his family now suffering? Why are his friends confused? And in the midst of all that wrestling for months, and then, of course, as you get older, you see these things many times as a pastor. You see these things come to pass too, these mysteries. The one answer I can give you is that we must learn to rest in the power of his wisdom. And maybe that's not the answer you want to hear this morning, but I believe eventually that's the answer you will need to hear. R. Kent Hughes explains it this way. He says, he will not do everything we ask, but he will do what is best for our well-being and for his glory. In the midst of it, it doesn't really seem like that. I get that. But he continues, he will bring his mercy and compassion to bear on the points of pain and need in our lives. He will bring healing. He will bring life. It may not be the way we see it at the time, or it may be the way that we want it. There's another passage in Scripture that always comes back to me in the midst of this. It says, his ways are higher than our ways, his thoughts higher than our thoughts. And so we may ask, why does God heal this person but not that person? And again, I think these are fair questions to ask, to bring before him. And again, I don't have the answer to that question, but I know that he ministers with a heart of deepest compassion, and he will bring healing to those who rest in him. I know that. So again, I say, if you're here this morning, you're filled with grief, you're filled with sorrow, I hope that you come to understand this morning, or are reminded this morning, that we worship and serve a compassionate and loving and tender-hearted God, that he sees you, he understands your pain, and he will minister to your heart in the midst of that pain. And lastly, may we learn to have a proper fear and reverence of God. Right? He isn't your homeboy. Right? He is our King. He is our Lord. He deserves the very best in our worship of him. Will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your passage this morning. We thank you that it reveals to us, a reminder to us, of your compassion for your people. Lord, that you would leave your throne in heaven to come pitch your tent among your people, to minister to them, to experience with them the frailties of this life, to experience the reality of suffering and death in a broken and sinful world. that you would know. Lord, I just thank you that your heart is filled with compassion towards us. Because if we're really honest, the only thing we deserve is your wrath and your judgment. But in that place, you have offered grace and mercy and tenderness and compassion. For people who have turned their backs on you, you've offered salvation. But Lord, my heart's heavy for those here who may be suffering with grief and sorrow. But I pray that that burden, that you would free them of that burden, Lord. Maybe they don't have the answers to why these things come to pass, but that you would minister to them, that they would just experience your compassion and your love for them in a new way, a profound way. Lord, and they would experience how much you truly love and care for them, and that your heart breaks alongside them as well. And Lord, for those who are wrestling with having to know why, Father, I just pray that they would be able to rest in you ultimately and eventually come to the understanding that you are good and that you are working in the midst of it. Father, I just pray that we as a church would fear you, that we would be in awe and in reverence of who you are, that we wouldn't nonchalantly approach your throne, but you just call us to boldly approach, but we would do so in humility and understanding of who you are and who we are, that we'd have reverence for you, that we can bring that to bear on this whole culture and community today, Lord. We'd be people who fear you and revere you, and in turn worship you and glorify and honor you, and then in turn proclaim your name to the world around us. So we thank you for the example that we see in your word today. Again, Lord, I just pray you'd fill our hearts with an unexplainable and inexpressible joy and peace in the midst of our sorrows and our trials. And we ask this in your mighty, precious, holy, and powerful name. Amen.
Would you stand as we sing together and revere him in awe as we sing the words from Psalm 146?
Praise the Lord, oh praise the Lord, as long.
so thankful when I see you at work in this little church, in this little town, in this little county in northern Michigan, among the United States, among the other nations of this globe. God, that in your sovereignty and in your grace, you would bring together the testimony of people from this community and story from your word this morning. It's not a coincidence that these things collided together this morning in our hearing. Father, that we would see from both that it is your intent to take what the world would regard as pointless suffering and by leaning heavily into the compassion of Jesus and by submitting to the leading of your Spirit, God, that you would give it a purpose and you would use it to make of us ministers of your goodness, of your Son. A ministry with a farther reach than we could ever imagine. Father, as we've seen this morning, you remind us through Jesus and his power over death, you remind us that there is coming a healing. There is coming a resurrection. There is coming a reunion. There is coming a time when you will gather up every tear that has fallen from the faces of your people. You will cause us to be one with you and with each other for eternity. The Apostle Paul exhorts us to encourage one another with these words. And so we have. Father, don't let it be in this moment only. Let us encourage one another with these things. Every day that we have together. Every day that we minister together. Every day that we love your Son together. We ask it in his name and for his sake. Amen. We close our time of corporate worship together, as we always do, with the words of Jesus from Matthew 5:14, where he says, "You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden." Let's go be the light. God bless you.